കഷ്ണം കഷ്ണം ചെയ്യാനുള്ള ഒരു ലക്ഷറി ഇല്ല. നീ ഇൻട്രൊഡക്ഷൻ തുടങ്ങിയിട്ട് ഇൻട്രൊഡക്ഷൻ ഒന്ന് കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ചെയ്യും. നിന്റെ റിസൾട്ട് നാളെ നിന്റെ ഗൈഡ് എന്നാണ് ചോദിക്കുന്നത്. നിന്റെ റിസൾട്ട്സിന്റെ കാര്യം അതെന്തായി? അത് നീ ആദ്യം ചെയ്യും. ബിക്കോസ് എന്നെ ഗൈഡിനായ ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ അതൊന്നും വലിയ വലിയ താല്പര്യം ഉണ്ടാവില്ല. അയാൾ അതൊന്നും വായിക്കാൻ പോകുന്നു. ഹി ജസ്റ്റ് വാണ്ട് ടു സീ യുവർ റിസൾട്ട്സ് ഡിസ്കഷൻ കൺക്ലൂഷൻ.
Good evening, everyone. Sorry, there was some electricity issue, so it took some time to sort that out. So I'll just wait for 2 minutes and we'll start the class.
मैं भूल गई.
Okay, good evening everyone. I think we shall start the class. Okay, so this class will not be having any question and answer session, so I'll be asking more like vocally I'll ask some questions. There will not be any MCQs, so let's start. So I'll be dealing with more from cell cycle checkpoints and briefly on cancer biology point of view. So I'll just give you a cell cycle overview, but I'll more focus on cell cycle checkpoints. Okay. So under these headings, we'll be discussing some basics about certain points, terms, then cell cycle.
What are the pictures?
So basics on certain terms, briefly about cell cycle, checkpoints, cancer biology, one or two slides about hallmarks of cancer cells. Okay. So most of the cells in the human body are quiescent. They don't divide much, but still per day there are 2 trillion divisions which happen. Okay. So the cells have only one job. If they are dividing rapidly, they have only one job: copy and segregate their genome into their daughter cells with perfection. Perfection has to be guaranteed. Okay, so to make sure perfection is there, our cells have created some surveillance points called cell cycle checkpoints. Okay, because the cells keeps getting exposed to intrinsic factors or extrinsic factors which actually cause damage. Intrinsically, it can be some sort of oxidative damage. From external side, there can be some chemicals, UV radiation, something like that. Okay. So in this situation, the cell or the DNA needs to take a call. Okay. It has two options. Either it can go into a repair process, or it can decide, okay, it's done. I can't repair this damage, and I'm dying. Apoptosis. Okay. So before going into cell cycle checkpoints and cell cycle in particular, so we need to understand some words called proto-oncogene, tumor suppressor gene, cyclins and cyclins dependent kinases, and CDK inhibitors and other related cell cycle machinery. Okay. So proto-oncogene, it's nothing but it's a gene which is present either, generally it's present in viruses. Of course, it's a part of human genome also, but it is under control. Okay, so if it is triggered, it will lead to malignancy. Okay, it can be mainly malignancy. It is of two types: either it will viral oncogene, which is introduced by the virus, or it's a cellular oncogene, which is also known as proto-oncogene. They are more importantly focused on cell growth and differentiation. These are the two functions of proto-oncogenes. Example, SRC, RAS, MYC, CIS, MYB. RAS, I think you might have heard in colon, KRAS and RAS. Okay, so tumor suppressor gene. It's also known as anti-oncogene. Its main function is to balance the function of proto-oncogene. Okay, it inhibits its either it's transcription products. They work to inhibit cell division, thereby preventing unnecessarily or unrequired cell growth, okay, which is also known as cancer or benign malignancy. Okay, example, retinoblastoma protein or P53. Okay, so yeah, here we are, cell cycle. So cell cycle, roughly, it's a simple diagram. Roughly, actually, if you look at the cell cycle, you have G1 phase, S phase, G2 phase, M phase. Okay. Just a simple question. What do you mean by G? If anyone can send a message, it will be good. Through the chat box. What do you mean by G? Okay. So yeah, we have two answers for saying gap. Any other word term for G other than gap? Yes, gap is growth. Okay, fine. Okay. So I think, okay, fine. It is nothing but gap. No growth, gap. Okay. So G is gap number one. G1, gap number one. S is synthetic phase. G2, gap number two. Okay. M is mitosis. Okay. So if you see the next slide, you'll understand that you have G1, S, G2, and M phase. And if you see a small point there where you have G1 or G0, okay. So G0 is nothing but interface. Okay, we will come to that point. But G1 and G0, only at G1, G0, why only a cell can enter? Someone can answer this. Okay. Why the cell can enter interface only in G1? Only in G1. Why not? I don't see it going into G0 in S phase or G2 or M. Okay, only at G1 it will go into G0. In other plates, other phases, it just goes into an arrest and either repairs or kills itself. Okay, in G1 only, before G1 or after coming to G1, it can take a call to go into G0. Why? Any answers? You can answer whatever answer you know. You can answer nothing, no problem about that. Okay, fair enough. So we have, yes, someone has sent an answer. After G1, DNA is replicated. Okay, we'll come to that. Okay, so in M phase you have prophase, prometaphase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase. Okay. Let's come to the answer. Okay, prophase, prometaphase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase. Okay, so during prophase, spindle fibers appear, chromosomes condense. Prometaphase, the slowly the spindle fibers come and attach to the chromosomes. Okay, and in the metaphase, you have a metaphase plate with chromosome with the spindle fibers attached to the metaphase chromosomes, and anaphase. Centromeres divide and slowly the chromatids move towards opposite poles. Telophase, you have completed the chromosomes in the opposite poles of the cell. Decondensation, nuclear membrane formation, spindle fibers disappear in. Cytokinesis splits. Okay. See this, actually we have read technical biology, we have covered in MBBS or even before. But what I want to do is go a bit deeper. Where, how does these spindle fibers appear? Why do these chromosomes condense? Like which protein pushes them to condense, and which protein causes spindle fibers formation? Okay, that I want to deal with. Okay, so as I told, I think we have discussed this. So interface. Is G1, GS, S, G2. Okay. Even though G0 is interface, it's more like cell has entered into division but has not gone through division. Roughly, yes, but interface generally says G0. Then gap 1, precentric phase, yes, DNA synthesis. G2, pre mitotic phase, cell division occurs in M phase. Okay. So the bottom line is, one cell becomes two, okay? But it's not that easy in reality. So what happens is you need to check how is the DNA before division. You need to oversee each step. You need to make sure cell cycle doesn't overshoot. Meaning, see, we want four cells, okay? Four cells, one becomes two, two becomes four, okay? After that four cells, we want the cell, or one becomes two. We just want two cells. We don't want the cell to become two to become four. Okay, so you need to make sure the cell cycle machinery stops at two. Okay, so how do you do that? So for that we create checkpoints. Okay, checkpoints. These are more like traffic police. They're like they stop everything, everywhere, and check. Even though the checking is not necessary. Okay. Notes are the previous lectures available? I think I have taken only one lecture regarding radiobiology, which is introduction. It's available. Okay, so checkpoints in the cell cycle. As I said, like policemen. Okay, they keep on checking unnecessarily. Yeah, even if the cell DNA is perfect, they want to check that. Okay, so how do they check that? So you have G1 checkpoint where they say, is the DNA is okay, enough resources for self replication, enough proteins are there, is environment is okay. Okay, please remember, when I say environment, you should remember the word potentially lethal damage in radiobiology. Okay, we'll come to the radiobiology, radiation damage and repair in the future classes, but yeah, when I say environment, please remember the word potentially lethal damage. Okay, then in G2, yeah, DNA is perfectly, because G2 comes after S phase, copied DNA is perfect or not, is it complete or not, for further division and everything, you have enough proteins that you do. And during M checkpoint, spindle fibers which are required for pulling the chromatids opposite direction, are they perfectly formed? Chromosomes are perfectly oriented? First, whether they are completely attached, all are attached or not, everything is checked. Okay, how do they check? I'll tell you. Okay, so as I said, G0, G1. So should the cell go into G1? And yes, okay, that is one question. Okay, so what happens is, this is called restriction point. Okay, why we call this restriction point is, for the cell to go from G1 to S till the S phase, the cell requires mitogenic signaling. Mitogen matlab any growth factor, it has to stimulate the cell so that the cell will go from G1 to S. Okay, if the mitogen or the growth factor is removed before the cell enters S phase, the division stops. Okay, so this is the point where the cell will decide, should we go through S phase, should I pause, should I go into interphase G0? That it will decide based on the surrounding conditions, especially requirement of growth factor. Okay, but is the growth factor required for all cells? Cancer cells, growth factors are required. Definitely not 100%, it is required, because cancer cells can divide without the requirement come in the future class, the next class. Okay, then so this is what Hello. No audio. Now, is it audible right now? Okay. So when was it cut? At which slide it was cut? Okay. Anyway, we'll start here itself. Yeah. See, the DNA has to go through to S phase. Okay. So if it wants to go to the S phase, it has to go through two proteins called retinoblastoma P53, which actually are tumor suppressor genes. So only if mitogenic stimulus is there, the DNA will pass through G1S transition point, checkpoint. Okay. But are retinoblastoma and P53 the only controls? Are there any other controls for cell cycle? Yeah. So that is what are the controls that are cyclins, CDKs, okay, and the concentrations of CDK inhibitors, other machinery, what is the status of retinoblastoma, RB protein, P53 protein, okay, and of course the activity of ATM and ADR, okay. Why I say this? Because this is a huge chart which says all the proteins, cell cycle machinery, CDKs, V, MIT1, RRR, polo-like kinases, INC4, SIPKIP, CDC25, ETF, blah, 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 too much to remember. Okay. So let's keep it simple. So cell cycle machinery, okay. Proteins or kinases, whatever. Cyclins, cyclin-dependent kinases, V1, MIT, okay. So we'll cover each and every name in detail, okay. So V1 and MIT1 are enzymes which phosphorylate the cyclin-dependent kinases and inactivate them, okay. So we'll cover that mechanism for the slides. Next one is CDK inhibitors. CDK inhibitors are two types. Okay. So one is INK4, meaning inhibitors of kinase 4, cyclin-dependent kinase 4 proteins, or CIP and KIP, kinase-interacting proteins. Okay, or cyclin interacting proteins. Okay, transcriptional control. So we have one proteins or protein inhibitors, then transcriptional control, which is in the form of retinoblastoma family or E2F transcription factors. Please remember E2F, it's a family, it's not only one. Okay, phosphatases, don't need to remember everything. Remember CDC25, okay. Last one is ubiquitin-dependent ligases or degradation, SCF and APC. We'll go step by step. At the end of the day, the cell cycle depends on two. Okay, you have positive regulators, you have negative regulators. It's about the balance between these two. Okay, in the presence of an outside factor or like a growth factor, which says divide, the cell divides. Positive regulators increase, cell divides. In the absence of that, negative regulators overpower and cell stays quiescent. Okay. So these are the positive regulators. Cyclins, cyclin-dependent kinases, CDC25. CDC25 is a family of phosphatases, which actually, if you look at the previous slide, I told you V1, MIT1, okay. They actually act or inactivate the cyclin-dependent kinases by phosphorylating the kinase, cyclin-dependent kinase. How do they do that? They phosphorylate the threonine residue in the active site, which leads to inactivation. Okay. CDC25 removes the inhibitory phosphorylation and activates the CDK kinase. Okay. So next one, negative regulators. Negative regulators mainly are RB proteins, P53 protein, okay, and the inhibitors of CDKs. These are of two types, as I told you, INC4, which is P15, P16, P18, P19, sorry. Yes. PPT, I doubt, but yeah, class will be shared. So INC4 family, inhibitors of kinase, 15, 16, 18, 19, okay. CIP or KIP, CDKs interacting protein or kinase interacting protein, which is 21, 27, 57, okay. So these are positive and negative regulators. And of course, we have violent regulators, which we will come in the further slides. There are two, SCF and APC. The reason why I say violent regulators, okay, if you see the RB and the P53, which are okay, they just go inhibit the CDK4 or cyclins and the CDKs. But these two, SCF and APCC, they just go and destroy that damn protein, okay, so that it will not even participate in the cell cycle, okay. So this is like more like a complete overview regarding how cyclin, CDK, everything acts in cell cycle. So if you see the cytokines growth factor come, okay, cyclin D is like you have cyclin D here interacting with in ion cyclin CDK4/6 forming the complex leading to E2F PRB phosphorylation leads to E2F release, which further increasing cyclin E CDK2, which is further after its activity is done, it will be destroyed by ubiquitin pathway. So on cyclin D, E, A, and B. D, E, A, B. So remember in that way. Okay, this is just an overview. We'll come into each part. Okay. So understanding the activity of cyclin CDK complexes. Cyclins are D, E, A, B. Cyclin dependent kinases are 1, 2, 4, 6, 7. And CDK activating kinase, that is the first one. Okay. And CDC25, which is a dual phosphatase, which activates the complexes. Okay. And they have CDK inhibitors. The reason why I'm saying cyclin activating kinase. Okay. So you have CDK4/6 with cyclin D activating and causing a cascade reaction. But what activates the cyclin D CDK4/6 complex? That is cyclin CDK activating kinase, which is CAK7, which starts the chain reaction, leading to further activation of further cyclin CDK complexes. Okay, so basic words. Okay, so cyclin has a cyclin box in its structure. In its amino acid structure, you have cyclin box. This actually says go and bind to a CDK. Okay. You need a certain target specificity, which it helps. Okay. And cyclin goes and binds to a P-stair domain that is present in the CDK. Okay. You have to remember cyclin box and a domain called P-stair, which is on the CDK. Okay. One more important point is types of phosphorylation. As I told you, you have activating phosphorylation, which is done by cyclin activating kinases, and deactivating or inhibitory, which is done by V and MIT1. Okay, so let's look at the picture. You have a CDK, you have a P-stair domain, and you have cyclin. Okay, so what happens is they both form a complex, leads to phosphorylation, which will create a phosphate residue on the top. Okay. And here you have cyclin CDK complex with it has attached to the substrate. Okay, you have a phosphate group here. Slowly the phosphate is transferred to the substrate. Okay, work done, immediately comes ubiquitin mediated degradation, which will cause cyclin CDK complex into piece by piece, it will destroy and safely you have a substrate with phosphorylation. That is the aim. Okay, simple as it goes. So this is the starting step. Okay, you have a growth factor. Especially cyclin D CDK4/6 complex or cyclin E CDK2. Even so, D and E both participate in this pathway, which is you have retinoblastoma protein, which has phosphorylated, like less number of phosphate groups are attached to it. Okay. And you have E2F family protein. I repeat, E2F family protein. Okay. So if the cyclin, the CDK complex, they hyperphosphorylate, means add more phosphorylated groups to the RB group, RB protein, which leads to E2F release. And E2F is a transcription regulator which is producing enzymes and proteins. Okay. This is the what? Can you hear some trouble. Can you hear me? You can hear me, right? There, you hear me, right? Voice not clear. Second, voice breaking. One second, just give me 2 minutes. How is it right now? Clear? Better. Okay. Fine. So this is what the traditional wisdom says. Okay, let's look at the actual pathway. Okay. So you have cyclin D and E. Okay, which actually you have a retinoblastoma gene, hyperphosphorylated. Okay. So, and along with that, you have E2F family protein. Okay. What actually this kinase complex does is, it will hyperphosphorylate the retinoblastoma gene. Okay. Which will lead to the release of E2F. Okay. This, along with the dimerization, DP, dimerization protein, will lead to formation of, depending on cell type, it can form either two paths, either transcriptional activators, which actually increase the cell cycle proliferation, like E2F1, E2F2, E2F3A, or it can also form transcriptional repressors, which is E2F4, E2F5, depending on cell type. Reason I am saying is, you need to remember cell types, tissue types, remember to correlate with radiobiology. Okay. Mitchell-Lasky classification or hierarchical system, all those things you need to coordinate. You have to correlate with this point. Okay. So, yeah. And currently we have current potential targets are cyclin CD, cyclin DE, CDK4/6 complex, where right now, you cells have found a path to divide without the combination of D and E with CDK4, okay, or D with CDK4. Itself, they themselves are dividing without the requirement of this complex. So it's a current potential target to decrease the cell division. Okay. So what happens with cyclin E? So when if, for example, the type of cell is a rapidly proliferating, for the sake of this presentation, let's take the cell as a rapidly proliferating. What happens is, so transcriptional activator. So E2F has led to increased transcriptional activation, which further produces cyclin E. And this cyclin E, as I told in the current previous slide itself, it will involve itself in hyperphosphorylate RB to further increasing the RB production and further increasing the E2F family release. Okay. And it also causes phosphorylation of P27. P27 is nothing but CYP-KIP family, where if you phosphorylate more, ubiquitin will come destroy that. Okay. And kam katam suicide bombing. It will self-phosphorylate and commit suicide. Okay, then further in cell cycle, what happens is D and E are over, D, E, A, B. So you have cyclin A, CDK2 complex, which is important for synthesis of DNA. How? Okay, so it is important for firing replication origins. So I think you might have, you might remember something called leading strand, lagging strand, replication fork, replication origins. Somewhere long time ago. So, and along with replication origins, it is also involved in the breakdown of nuclear membrane. Okay. And once it is done, as I said, ubiquitin pathway destruction. Okay. So then comes the G2M phase. So you have done, you have finished cyclin A CDK2, then you have come to G2M phase, which this cycle, this checkpoint is controlled by mainly cyclin B CDK1 complex. Okay. This complex causes condensation of chromosomes via condensin 1 and 2. Breakdown along with cyclin A, B causes breakdown of nuclear membrane, and most importantly, separation of chromatids. Okay. So how does it involve in separation of chromatids? Okay. It's a master molecule. That is why, because it actually has role in chromatin condensation via condensin 1 and 2, role in nuclear envelope breakdown so that the chromosomes or chromatids can go into the cytoplasm and start the procedure properly. And of course, you have multiple organelles in the cell. If they are interfering with, this, with the chromatid separation, it will be difficult. Okay. Then you have spindle formation. Even that is controlled by cyclin B CDK1 complex. Okay. So let's come to this part. How does cyclin B CDK1 complex? Okay. So this part, it will inhibit MIT and V1. Okay. MIT and V1, what they do, they inhibit the, so you have cyclin I. Once it is activated, you have it does inhibition of MIT V1, which actually what they do, they inhibit, they phosphorylate the rearrange residue and cause inhibitory phosphorylation. So if it is inhibited, it will be active only, and it activates the CDC25, which actually increases the activity by removing the inhibitory phosphorylation of MIT and V1. So that is what it does. It will increase further activation of further itself and block inhibition. Okay. So this is actually, we will come to this later, but I'll just give a brief overview. Okay. See, this is prometaphase where there is no tension in the center of the chromosome. Okay. And once metaphase comes, there is a lot of tension in the center. Okay. So what actually happens is, this is called, see, the chromatids actually, if you look at the procedure, I'll tell you. So you have cytoplasm, the organelles, the Golgi apparatus has been destroyed. The chromatids have condensed. Nuclear membrane has disappeared. And the chromatids are slowly going out into the cytoplasm. And then you have spindle fiber apparatus formation. Okay. And then you have, they have attached to the center, and the prometaphase, they have attached, just attached. Okay. But during metaphase or metaphase anaphase transition, what happens is the spindle fibers start pulling the chromatids to the opposite folds. So at that time, what happens is there's a protein called MAT2. Okay. What this does is, this actually has a complex with CDC20. Okay. CDC20 is one of the protein. This and MAT2 have a complex. Okay. And because of that, they inactivate the APCC complex. Okay. APCC complex, if you remember, it is one of the ubiquitin guided pathway. Okay. So once this tension increases, this MAT2 and CDC2, they separate. This CDC2 comes and joins APCC complex, which leads to the securin is destroyed by APCC complex. Securin, which is inhibiting the separase enzyme, is destroyed by APCC. Separase is free and active, which causes destruction of the cohesion protein, and they are spread. So this happens in anaphase. So I repeat, MAT2 protein has a complex with CDC20. When there is no tension, when there is tension, which is in a metaphase and anaphase, when there is tension, the CDC20 is released, becomes a part of APCCC. APCCC, once it activates after a joining of CDC20, it destroys securin. Destruction of securin activates separase. Separase goes and destroys the protein called SCC1. SCC1 is a part of cohesion. See, you have the entire chromatids in the prometaphase. They are oriented exactly in the center. Okay. This is called bioorientation. Bioorientation. This is facilitated by a protein called cohesin. Cohesin is made up of SCC1, SCC3, SM1, SM3. When you cleave SCC1, you separate the chromatids at the center. So which is done by separase. Okay. So I know it's a lot to take in, but try to keep up. Okay. So we keep hearing this ubiquitin mediated degradation, blah blah blah. What is this? Okay. So we have SCF complex. So you have SCP2 protein, SKP2 protein. You have a cullin protein, okay. Then you have RBX1 protein. The RBX1 protein has only one job, that is E2 and ubiquitin conjugate. See, the green part is the ubiquitin. So this is more like, what do you say? They are like, I am a suicide bomber, come and kill me. Okay, so Ake Maro. Literally, it's a tagline. It's like a tag, red color symbol for them. Come and kill me. Okay. So this RBX protein is helps in recruiting this protein. So the gang leader for this group, SCF complex, is SKP2, which brings everyone together. RBX1 brings E2F. And you have an F-box protein. F-box is nothing but, it's a protein in this entire SCF complex. This actually is important for target specificity. Okay, you can't go on destroying everyone, right? You have to destroy only separate specific proteins. So to destroy specific proteins, that is the job of this F-box. So only these proteins have to be destroyed. Okay. So what happens is, you have the target. So once, what happens is, you have cullin, all this enter complex, you have a target. Once the target attaches to F-box, the ubiquitin is transferred to the target. And the procedure repeats itself so that there is a chain, polyubiquitin chain. So once that polyubiquitin chain is formed, okay, immediately the ubiquitin guided destruction happens. Okay. And you have APCC complex. What happens here is, I think you remember APCC complex during the previous slide. I think here, yeah, you can see the APCC complex. Okay, so you don't see anywhere SCF complex. SCF complex finishes its job around something like G1 S phase itself, but after G1 S phase, it's more towards active APCC complex. Okay, we'll talk about that further in this slide. Here, what happens is during G2M and intra-M phase, okay, checkpoint, what happens is this is the APCC complex. Okay, you have APC2 protein, APC11 protein, E2F conjugate, E2F ubiquitin conjugate, almost similar structure. And you have, CDC20. CDC20 is a cofactor. I think you might remember MAT2 and CDC20. So once the tension increases, the CDC20 is released, it comes and joins this area, activates the APCC complex. So target has attached. So in this situation, what was the target? The target was securin. So once securin has come, immediately ubiquitin path, ubiquitin has been transferred, it will get destroyed. But not all times CDC20 is a cofactor and securin is the target. Okay, you have multiple types of proteins. But after the mitotic exit, okay, what happens is the same complex, but here the target is changed, because after mitotic exit you have a lot of cyclin D, cyclin A, multiple proteins are there. So at that time the cofactor, instead of CDC20, you have CDH1. Okay, so it will destroy all the proteins which are there and which are not required further. Okay, if you remember in the starting itself, I told you the importance of cell cycle checkpoints is to make sure the cell doesn't overshoot, meaning when you need two cells, you need to stop at two. So if you leave the cyclin D, B, A, everything intact, it can cause further cell cycle, which has to be prevented. More cell cycles can occur, or cell division can occur, which has to be prevented, and that prevention is done by APCC complex in the form of this. Okay, so stressing on checkpoints, there are four checkpoints. As I said, I think we have just a brief overview about the cell cycle and checkpoints. Four checkpoints in a cell. Okay, so you have G1 and S checkpoint, intra S checkpoint, G2 M checkpoint, intra M checkpoint. People keep telling checkpoint, checkpoint, checkpoint. What do you mean by checkpoint? Okay, so the simplest way to explain is you need to check whether the cell cycle will go without any hitches. Okay, so for this there are mainly two type of proteins are involved. One is ATM, ataxia telangiectasia mutated, and ATR, ATM and RAD3 related proteins. Okay, these two proteins, ATM and ATR, they are involved in checkpoints. Okay, only thing is they need to be recruited. Okay, so for that recruitment to happen, you need to know whether the damage has occurred or not. So the damage checking and everything happens through MRN complex, MRE, RAD50, NBS1. This complex recruits these two proteins to the site of the damage. What happens at the site of the damage? Okay, it depends on G1, where the damage has occurred. It can happen in G1, it can happen in intra-S, it can happen in G2M. So if there is a damage, MRN complex is there, and then it recruits the ATM or ATR proteins to the point, and these two proteins activate checkpoint kinases 1 and 2. Okay, ATM is more towards checkpoint 2, ATR is checkpoint kinase 2, and ATR is more into checkpoint kinase 1. Okay, I think this also you need to remember, repair machinery, gamma 2. This, I think I remember that something in the repair pathway itself. Okay, we will come to that part later. So once the checkpoint kinase are activated, okay, so once these are activated, you need to make sure the cell division doesn't occur. You need to stop the cell cycle. Okay, so for the cell cycle to be stopped, what they do is they go and phosphorylate all CDC25 proteins. CDC25, you remember dual phosphatase, which activates the cell cyclin CDK complexes by removing the phosphate, which was put by inhibitory phosphorylation of V1 and MIT1. That CDC25, it is phosphorylated. If it is phosphorylated, it can either get destruction destroyed by ubiquitin pathway, or it can be just inhibition by 14-3-3 protein, okay, which will lead to CDK inactivation, okay, or it can also cause P53 protein phosphorylation. So P53 has a suicide bomber along with it, that is called HDM2. Okay, HDM2, P53, if the cell cycle has to go in a very nice way, P53 has to be in very low quantity. If you put P53 in high quantity, it will start either it will stop the cell cycle or it will kill the cell. Okay, so for that low concentration, it has a bond with HDM2 protein. Okay, if these two bond is happening, it is destroyed by ubiquitin destruction. If it is phosphorylated, P53 phosphorylated protein and HDM2 separate, and it is stabilized. If it stabilizes, it will either see if there is a requirement, if can we repair the cell, you block the cell cycle, you by activating P21, increasing the transcription of P21 and block the cell cycle by blocking CDK activity. If you feel that cell cannot survive, increase the production of pro-apoptotic genes, TCL2, BAC-BIM-BACs, kill the cell. Okay, that is what happens by P53. Okay, so as I told you, this is one more checkpoint. This is intra-M checkpoint, as I told you. So all chromosomes. Okay. I think I have typed this in the wrong way. Yeah. So till all the chromosomes are in the central axis, till all are in metaphase plate. Okay. This I told you, MAD1, MAD2 proteins, they don't allow the fibers to touch. Okay. Or else, if MAD1, MAD2, if they actually attach, the CDC20 will activate. MAD1, MAD2, they won't allow the attachment of fibers, or they will not allow CDC20 to activate the APCC. Okay, they keep a strong hold over CDC20. Okay, first the checkpoint has to complete its normal process, which all the chromosomes have to attach, have to line up in the center of the cell by a procedure called bioorientation. Only if everything is in one place, then this MAD1, MAD2 proteins allow. Okay. So clinically, I think we have discussed this in the last class itself. Why is G2M most sensitive and S most resistant to radiation? Okay. S phase has abundant repair enzymes and they can repair the damage rapidly. But the same enzymes, even though they are present in G2M phase, what happens is the DNA is tightly packed, okay, in the chromosomes. Okay, I think this is the gift of cycling B. So when it is tightly packed, okay, you can't create replication points or replication origins or replication fork when the DNA is tightly coiled. So tightly coiling of the chromosome or the DNA makes the enzymes for the enzymes very difficult to go to the site and repair the damage. Okay, so I told you too much about cell cycle and checkpoints. It takes some time to remember all those things, but let's simply talk about cancer biology. Okay, I will not go into much cancer biology. I'll just briefly skim through that. Okay, so cancer biology happens like tumor induction. It depends on mutations or lack of or loss of control mechanism over the loss of cell control mechanisms. Though mechanisms mostly are proto-oncogenes, tumor suppressor genes, and DNA stability repair mechanisms. Any mutation of these or any loss of control over this can cause induction of cancer. Okay, so proto-oncogene. So this gene, what does it code for? Okay, it is mainly important for production of growth factors, or it can be for production of receptors. It can be for transmembrane kinase proteins. So for the message from the cell cycle, cell membrane to the nucleus, there will be a downstream pathway. Those proteins are intranuclear transcription factors. It can be any one of them. Okay, so any one can produce carcinogenesis. Okay, so this is a normal cell. So you have a growth factor, you have a growth factor receptor, cytoplasm, signal transduction, nucleus, and the activation transcription of DNA. Okay, so what happens is, in the malignant cell, either it can increase the production of growth factors, either autocrine or paracrine pathway. It can increase growth factor receptor. See, you have, well, normally what cells do is, for example, 10 power 5 growth factor receptors are there. In malignant cells, it can increase to 10 power 10. Okay, you have a surplus of growth factors, but still, when you don't have enough receptors, the signal won't go much, more signal won't go inside, and the cell is not stimulated more than what it is required. But when you increase the receptor number, it can go into induction of carcinogenesis. And yes, of course, you can also increase signal transduction. Okay, and of course, you can increase activation of transcription also. So this is an example where, even without the presence of outside receptor, you have a transcriptional activation of continuous activation of tyrosine kinase enzyme inside. Okay, so how does it get activated? So you have tumor initiators, viruses, carcinogenic chemicals, chemicals, physical process like UV radiation. So that can initiate tumor damage by causing damage to the DNA. Okay, so yeah, this is a simple slide explaining how tumor induction can happen by a suppressor gene defect. It can increase in oncogenesis, increase in activation of oncogene, effective control. So all these processes can cause tumor induction. Okay, so tumor suppressor genes. So I think our favorite are retinoblastoma B and p53 plus HDM2. I think we have discussed this in detail, how RB works and everything. So any damage, any problem in the RB pathway can form tumor, can increase tumor induction. And of course, p53 plus HDM2, as I told you, more like a suicide bomber. Okay, so p53, if it has to act, it requires phosphorylation. That phosphorylation, so p53 has to, if it needs to act, it requires phosphorylation. Just imagine if there is a mutation in the p53, and even if it is phosphorylated, it is not able to stop the cell cycle. Just imagine what happens. Even if the checkpoint kinase phosphorylates the p53, it can't stop the cell cycle. So when you don't stop the cell cycle, even in the presence of damage, what happens is, increase in the number of damages, increase in the number of mutations, the cell cycle will go on, will increase the chance of tumor induction. Okay, so as I said, so you have ATM protein, activation of CHK2 kinase, so which causes p53 and MDM2. So if that's there, you have safe ubiquitin pathway is there, destruction. But if it is phosphorylated, you have a stable p53, and which goes and increases the production of p21, and the cell cycle will not go forward. Okay, this is how p53 acts. So if there is any damage to the p53, p21 is not produced and cell cycle will go on. Okay, and same one. So last one, hallmarks of cancer cells. I'll not go much into this. Six fundamental changes. Cell sufficiency in growth factors. Okay. So you don't need, so the tumor cells will change in such a way that they don't need growth factors from outside the cell. Okay. So they may have a continuously active tyrosine kinase pathway. Okay. Or they can have a increased transduction, as I told you, all these points. Okay. And second thing is insensitivity to growth inhibitor signals. So you have P53 gene, which is saying don't divide. So that protein, if it is destroyed, okay, so still that protein is still mutated. Okay, there is no stoppage to cell cycle. That is one. Evasion of apoptosis. So apoptosis happens only when P53 increases transcription of pro-apoptotic genes. So when P53 itself is mutated, you can't go into apoptosis, and the cell has successfully evaded the apoptosis. Limitless replicative potential. Okay, so as I said, once the cell has undergone some certain amount of mutations, they don't stop at certain level. Okay, you have a telomerase enzyme which will continuously produce telomeres at the end of the telomeres. The length of telomeres is not shortened, so it keeps on dividing without the problem of shortening of telomeres. Okay, telomerase enzyme keeps on increasing it, and there is no, as I said, the APCC complex, it has to say this is enough. Ubiquitin pathway, APCC complex, these two have to say enough is enough. No need for cycling CDK complexes now. Let's destroy them. If that is not happening, the cells keeps on dividing. Okay, sustained angiogenesis. So once a cell reaches a critical size, okay, this the nutrition will not be able to come to the center of the cell, center of the mass. Okay, at that time, the VEGF factor is produced, and which causes neovascularization. Okay, so generally till certain size, that neovascularization won't happen. But if the tumor cells will be able to create more VEGF factors, you can have multiple new vessels coming into the tumor cells without a problem of necrosis. Ability to invade and metastasize. So tumor cells need to produce certain enzymes like metalloproteinases to invade the stroma of the body. Okay, in any organ, stroma has to be invaded, and that invasion happens through destruction of the stroma through enzymes like metalloproteinases. But for metastasis to happen, you have to achieve the cell has to be bound to the basement membrane. Okay, some multiple proteins are there, so which actually needs to be intact for the cell to be bound to the cell membrane, basement membrane. But if these proteins are mutated, so that will lead to or lost mutation mutated or lost that will lead to the cell being loose. Okay, that loose cell along with the metalloproteinases can invade the vessels, and it can spread to other areas. Okay, these are the basic fundamental changes for cancer cells. In emerging hallmarks, which are avoiding immune destruction, tumor promoting inflammation, genome instability and mutation, and deregulating cellular energetics. Okay, so depending more on ATP rather than going into Krebs cycle or oxidative phosphorylation, you depend more on glycolysis. So that is more shifting the cell metabolism into glycolysis rather than going. That is deregulation of cellular or energetics. Okay. So thank you. So my point is, actually, this is a very complicated presentation. I have read cell cycle almost every year once I'll read, but still I forget. Okay. So I tried to make it as simple as possible. So there is no point actually, if even if I repeat myself, until or unless you read, I don't think you'll be able to remember it. So any questions? Any doubts, any questions? I thought of putting a clear take home message, but I thought that will itself will take 3 or 4 slides. So I didn't put any take home message. So you need to listen to the class again. I think it will be uploaded to YouTube, so you can listen to it. So do you have any doubts right now, or people are too confused to remember it itself? Okay, so if there are no doubts, thank you for listening. We'll meet later. I think we'll be planning mostly either cell cycle repair or microgliomas. Let me see. What is the consensus regarding contouring sessions? Okay, you can WhatsApp me. We'll talk later. Okay, then. Take care. Bye.